boroughs, this is Deontay the Bronze Bummer Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom, for the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Is Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out one. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com.
Hello everyone, welcome to another live episode of Real Fans Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. We got a great show lined up for you tonight. The NFL playoffs are just around the corner. We got one more week in the regular season with a lot of playoff implications, a lot to talk about. And we had sleigh bells ringing last week with Santa here. Now sometimes you just need more cowbell for those of you that get the Christopher Walken SNL reference as my comedy t-shirts continue. But before we get into football and the sports talk, let me introduce the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
What's going on, man? I'm happy. It was a great Christmas. If you notice, I came in wearing my Cavaliers hat after they, snatched the victory from the jaws of defeat and beat the Golden State Warriors on Christmas Day, you know, which made me very happy. I'm in a good space. It's about to be a new year, you know, new year, new money. It's going down, man. What can I say?
Well, Santa Claus got some predictions wrong last week. He did say that your Cavs would win, which made you happy, but he also said that the Giants win, which they did not. And it made our director Clifford very happy. So maybe you just weren't that nice last year and Santa didn't really give you what you want.
No.
But they still made the playoffs, so I guess it didn't really matter.
But that's not what it was. What I think happened, okay, is the reason why Santa got his prediction wrong is because Carson Wentz tried to play Santa Claus, went out and bought shotguns for each member of his offensive line. So what I think happened was, you know, somebody might have sent a little message to Santa, you know, in regards to his prediction. They tried to put the pressure on him.
Well, they're not in the playoffs, so they have time. You know, it's a little cold to go golfing, so maybe he figured they'll go hunting since they're not in the playoffs.
Well, that's understandable.
They're 6-9, so even if they somehow magically beat the Cowgirls this week, they will still have a losing record.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, I mean, the minor victories for the Eagles fans out there, like our director Clifford, he was happy that they were up at halftime last week and made sure that we knew about it. So
he definitely did post
a victory in a game that meant nothing to them. And,
yeah.
You know.
Well, I mean, it happens when you're on a drought like the Eagles are, you know, when guys like Eli Manning have more than the entire organization, you know, it's kind of sad. And, you know, but you know what? You can have the little moment, you know, you guys have a little extra time to work out for next season. And, you know, we'll continue to get ourselves together for the playoffs. You know, we got to make another deep run into the playoffs. So we're looking forward to to that.
Now back to teams that are actually in the playoffs. The Giants, for those of you Giants fans out there, they will be playing the Redskins, which has no playoff implications for them, whether they lose or not. They will be the fifth seed. And unfortunately, even though they have a better record than the other, you know, division winners, that's just not the way the NFL works. So if the Seahawks lose, the Giants would play the Seahawks. Now, if the Seahawks win and the Lions and Falcons win, they would play the Lions. If the Seahawks wins and the Lions wins, but the Falcons lose, the Giants would play the Falcons. If the Packers wins, that trumps everything. And, you know, the Packers would play the Giants in Lambeau Field. And it seems like the Giants go through Lambeau when they win Super Bowls. So
wouldn't be mad at that. Not at all. Another win in Lambeau for the Giants. They used to going on the road in the playoffs and, snatching those victories. So I'm not mad at that. You know, plus I think, I mean, we know who the best team in football is, you know, so, you know, I think it's gonna be a nice little playoff run for the Giants. Looking forward to it. Someone who is not going to have that same run, though, is those Oakland Raiders, because they do not have Derek Carr anymore. He's out for the season with a leg injury, which really sucks because they were having a great season. And now they have to defend on a non-existent defense and the backup quarterback, which I don't think they'll be able to last in the first round of the playoffs.
Now, that leads to a fan mail question. Michael from Queens wrote in, how many playoff games, if any, can the Raiders win without Derek Carr? Now, the Raiders are in a situation where they could get, a first-round bye. They just have to beat the Broncos this Sunday. Now, they're not going to beat the Patriots. Everyone else, I think they could win this Sunday against the Broncos to clinch that first-round bye. They have a chance because the Broncos' run defense isn't that great, even though their pass defense is good. And we saw last time they played Oakland, Latavius Murray had a field day with them. So it's possible that the running game can get them through some teams. But, I mean, it really depends on the matchups. I don't see them playing the Patriots unless they could get a bye and the first round. But they can't get past the Patriots in the AFC Championship game, which is probably – there's a good chance for that to happen, I would think.
Honestly, I think
I don't think they can beat the Steelers. They could probably. It all depends on how things match up, and I'll write a blog to explain everything to you. Because just explaining the Giants one got Tripp Young confused. So maybe if you guys see it on writing on the RealFansRealTalk.com website, I'll go through all the different hypothetical situations there, and then you know we can take it from there. But it really all depends on the matchup. I think that they could beat the Texans or the Dolphins. I don't think that they could beat the Steelers, though.
Honestly, I'm just happy that they already clinched their playoff spot, because I don't think that if this game against the Broncos, if that was the deciding factor in whether or not they make the playoffs, I don't think they would be into the playoffs. I don't think they're going to beat the Broncos. And maybe they could beat the Texans just because they're so horrible. But outside of that, I don't see them beating any other team without Derek Carr. They don't have a defense. And now you're talking about the backup quarterback. I mean, if he comes in and he plays like Dak Prescott did this season, then maybe. But I don't think they have enough without Derek Carr to beat any other teams except, like I said, maybe the Texans, because they're just horrible as well this season.
Well, if the Raiders do lose and the Chiefs win, then the Chiefs get the division and the first round bye, and that will drop the Raiders in to the fifth place wild card seed. The Raiders still, if the Raiders win and the Patriots lose, they still have a chance to take, you know, clinch home field throughout the playoffs. So, I mean, still a lot of playoff implications, and the Patriots are playing the Dolphins. A lot of different scenarios could go around with who plays who, but bottom line is the six teams that are in the playoffs, just a matter of who plays who, is the Patriots, the Dolphins, the Steelers, the Texans, the Raiders, and the Chiefs. The Dolphins are one wild card at the sixth place spot, and then the Raiders or the Chiefs would be the other. So,
well,
actually, you got a weird actual tiebreaker scenario. Excuse me. If the Dolphins somehow beat the Patriots and the Chiefs lose, then you got to go through. They both have the same division record. They both have the same conference record. They didn't play each other. So you go through strength of schedule. Like, the whole tiebreaker procedures are very long. I went into detail on one of the blogs on the RealFansRealTalk.com website. It really all comes down to a coin flip if all other scenarios are tied. So that's very unlikely, because I think the Pats will take care of business against the Dolphins. So
yeah, because they're not resting anybody in this game. They want to make sure they secure that home field. And, I mean, it's making it a lot better for the Patriots, I think, to go to the Super Bowl this season, because, you know, that's a huge hit. And I just don't think anybody else has it.
Now, the Giants, like I said, they could lose. They're the fifth seed no matter what. But if the Redskins win, they are in. They, you know, they had one tie game that brings their record to 9-6-1, which would put them into the playoffs. Now, do the Giants play all their starters and go full force to eliminate the Redskins from playoff contention?
I mean,
even though it's a meaningless game for them, in the sense that
I might as well just rest and just get those guys, just get ready for the playoffs. Maybe if they play a quarter, maybe the half at most. But
I mean, Eli Manning's gonna want to play. He obviously has that active streak, longest active streak.
Yeah, so he'll probably still start. Yeah. But, you know, I don't see them playing
even
the
starters the
entire game.
Even though
the
Redskins beat the Giants, you don't think that they'd want to make sure that they're
They want to make sure that they go into the playoffs healthy, especially with Javaris Jenkins, you know, tweaking, you know.
Well, he's not going to play.
A little bit. Like, you don't want to take the chance for anybody else because they can't afford to lose another player. They already don't have JPP anymore for the season. If, you know, and Javaris Jenkins, who's taking his time to come back, but, you know, you don't want to risk losing another key player just, you know, to try to make sure the Raiders don't get in. Who cares? I think the Giants can beat the Raiders in the playoffs anyway, so.
Redskins,
in the playoffs anyway.
Yeah, well, I mean, there'd be, you know, two wild card teams, so the chances of them playing each other is very unlikely unless they both go through all the division champions, so. Unlikely in that scenario. So now in the Eastern Conference, the Cowgirls, of course, clinching home field throughout the NFC. We talked about the Giants and Redskins. The Packers and Lions are in contest for the division, and that game goes down Sunday night, and they play each other. So that's one way to really decide the division is when the two teams play each other in the last week, and it's on Sunday Night Football. That would be a big one. As I said, one of the Giants could be playing the Packers or the Lions, depending on what happens with that one. And then Atlanta wins their division. Seattle won their division. The teams that are in the hunt, other than the ones that I mentioned, are the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They would need the Redskins to lose, and they would have to win their game against New Orleans, and Green Bay would have to beat Detroit. So,
well, I'll tell you what's definitely going to happen is Green Bay is going to beat Detroit. Aaron Rodgers is going to go on to win the MVP. They're going to play the Giants. The Giants are going to beat them, go all the way to the Super Bowl, and beat the Patriots because they are Tom Brady's kryptonite. So that's how it's going to break down. You know, basically, I just mapped the whole thing out for you and all of the folks at home.
I mean, I agree with your hypothesis over there, scenario. But which team out of the AFC do you think has the best chance to beat the Patriots, especially now that Carr is out for the season, for the playoffs?
I just don't think any of those teams can beat the Patriots. I'm sorry.
Carr been healthy, do you think?
I don't think they could have. Like, I just don't think they have the experience or the defense. They're not going to stop Tom Brady in Foxborough, so that's out of the question. So, and I don't think
they had a chance at still having home field too. But
well, yeah, they had a chance at home field, but now, you know, it's pretty much like I don't see the Patriots losing this week. So, which means you're going to have to go through Foxborough in order to, you know, to get to the Super Bowl. And I don't think any of these teams can beat Tom Brady in Foxborough.
Now, hypothetically, if the Giants don't come out of the NFC, because I think we both agree that the Giants are coming out of the NFC.
So why are you asking me this question?
Just for the sake of...
All right, go ahead. I'm going to let you get your question out there, Statman.
What team do you think has the best chance, besides the Giants, to come out of the NFC?
You know what? Honestly, if it's not the Giants, and I know this is crazy, but it would probably be the Cowgirls to do it. And in which case, if the Cowgirls actually did win the Super Bowl this year, I would not be upset because, you know, that would be a rookie African-American quarterback starting and a running back, rookie African-American running back to lead the Cowgirls to a Super Bowl win. So I would not be upset if that was the case. But I don't see that happen anyway because I think it's going to be the Giants that's gonna go. But if it wasn't them, the Cowgirls.
Now, since you mentioned Dak Prescott and Ezekiel Elliott, who do you think is the front runner now for the MVP? Carr was in the situation, but now he's injured. But at the same time, you're supposed to go by regular season. You're not supposed to count playoffs. Is Carr still in contention for the MVP because of the season that he had?
He's still,
even though he's missing the last game, or what do
he's
you
still in contention. But I think it was really close, and I think it was gonna come down to this last game, and that's why I'm saying it's gonna go to Aaron Rodgers because he's gonna play today. He's on Sunday. He's gonna come out and he's gonna play, and they're going to beat the Lions as they usually do. He's going to have a 300-yard, 2-3 touchdown game. They're going to go on to the playoffs. He's definitely gonna get the MVP. I think that if Carr had a chance to play this week, it could have made things interesting. But I just think, you know, Aaron Rodgers really just completely turned the season around for the Packers. He said a couple of weeks ago, he said, we're not going to lose any more games. They have not. Since he's made that statement, they're not going to lose to the Lions. And that's going to be, he's going to get the MVP. I know other people like Dak and you might like Ezekiel Elliott, but I think they cancel each other out for MVP. Plus, I mean, it's kind of the trifecta with the Cowgirls as far as MVP, because it's Dak, Zeke, and the offensive line who
should get the MVP, in my opinion. So that's exactly why I think both of those are out of the question.
Yep.
I mean, I still feel that Derek Carr should get it. You know, Aaron Rodgers had a horrible first half of the season. I mean, you go by the whole season, but I think just the first half of the season playing horrible, I don't think that he should get it. I'm against Tom Brady getting it just because he missed the first four games, and you can't. I personally don't agree with that. But what's your take now that we see the Patriots season almost in full?
I still think it's going to go to Aaron Rodgers. Even though I'm not against Tom Brady getting MVP, I just don't think that he will get it. I really think that Aaron Rodgers did enough to sway the voters in his direction.
If they lose against Detroit, then Aaron Rodgers is out of the question.
Oh, if they lose to Detroit, it's out of the question, but I just don't see that happening. Like, I pretty much think like that's signed, sealed, and delivered. I don't know what's going on with Stafford's hand. He had that was his thumb. So I'm not even sure how he's going to play, this Sunday. But I know how Aaron Rodgers is going to play, like the best quarterback in the NFL, and he's going to win this game. They're going to go on, and they're going to give it to Aaron Rodgers. That's pretty much going to be the end of it. No more Derek Carr, so he can't play to try to put those numbers up. You know, especially if the Raiders win this weekend without him, I think it's definitely gonna hurt him. So we'll see.
Do you think the Redskins win this Sunday if the Giants are resting players?
It's possible, but I think the Giants are gonna play long enough to where it won't matter. I think they'll put them away. I think they'll be up by two touchdowns at the half.
And the Skins did hand us one of our losses.
And that's why they're going to play hard that first half, because they know they're not going to play the second half. But I think they'll just be out of it. But we got to wait and see.
All right, there you have it. Another fan mail question. Switching over to what you mentioned earlier, switching over to basketball. Your Cavaliers did win on Christmas Day. Kurt from Nassau County, Valley Stream, wrote in, who is more to blame for the Warriors' blown lead in the fourth quarter? Steph Curry, Kevin Durant, Draymond Green, or Steve Kerr?
For the blown lead in the fourth quarter, I gotta go with Kevin Durant. And the reason why I'm going with Durant is because Steph pretty much was consistently doing nothing the entire game. I mean, he was setting up some screens and making some passes, but for the most part, that kid Liggins, pretty much contained Steph Curry. Whereas Durant was balling 3.5 quarters. I think like it got to maybe like the last 5 or 6 minutes. He just missed a couple of shots. I mean, we know the little controversial turnover at the end, but I think he started to decline as the game went on. Same thing with Draymond. I mean, he from the jump, if you were talking about the game, I probably would say Steph Curry. But I think for the collapse at the fourth quarter, I got to go with Durant, because he was the guy that was holding it down for them the entire way. And then he just, low starts to decline a little bit. And then there you go. You get a Richard Jefferson dunking on Klay Thompson. Kyrie turned around, jump shot over Klay, and boom, there you go.
36 years old?
I mean, he's up. He's definitely up there. I'm not mad at Richard Jefferson. You definitely have a chance to make a poster, man, because he definitely posterized Klay Thompson, so you definitely got to love that. But, I mean, the team, things were close. It was a game. Like, everybody was into the game, from pretty much from wire to wire. I guess that kid is
for anything yeah. more as far as you know, on Christmas having yeah. a good game is you know whether you're a fan of either team or not, you know, unless you're a Warriors fan, then maybe not.
But they still you saw a good game as a Warriors fan because it came down to the wire. Like the lead was jumping back and forth in the last couple of minutes. So even if you're a Warriors fan, you don't like the fact that your team lost, but you definitely liked the game. It was a good game. Durant played well. You know, Thompson played well. You know, so you still the team was in it up until literally the last 20 seconds. The team was in it. It just so happened that the Cavs, you know, got the W in the end. And I'm very happy about that one. So, you know, I'm all good now. Now, if they go to the Golden State and lose, I can accept that. But they won on Christmas in Cleveland. So, it doesn't get better than that as far as regular season. We know, like, the big games, you know, and that's those Christmas Day games. Like, those are the games that all the fans love when your team plays on Christmas. And when they get that W for you on Christmas, you get bragging rights after you open your gift. So you probably be playing NBA 2K17 or Madden, because I just got to Madden this. So I was playing Madden, you know, this week. But, you know, you're going to be on the systems. So you definitely, you know, want to enjoy your team getting the W and then go enjoy the PS4 or the Xbox, whichever one you're playing.
Yeah, definitely. Now, Kevin Durant's, you know, pretty much doing his job consistently as a Warrior from what I'm seeing. Steph Curry, maybe not so much. Is it still Steph Curry's team, or do you think it's more Kevin Durant's team now?
I think it's still Steph Curry's team, but I think they don't have a particular identity just yet because, you know, that's a huge addition to add a Kevin Durant. You know what I mean? It's who was coming in. And it's not like a situation in Miami where you have, you know, Wade, even though they came in at the same time, but Wade's a little bit older. You know, he's got the injury, so LeBron could come in and still be. But I think in this situation, you're coming off of Steph Curry being back-to-back MVP. You can't just come to Golden State, you know, even though, and they're all getting pretty much the same amount of shots still. Like, you know, it may be like a shot or two difference. One night Steph may have taken more, one night Klay may have, one night Durant may have taken more shots. But I just don't think they have an identity just yet of how they're going to actually play. I think they will get it in time. But I mean, when you play in these games, you know, against the Cavs, these games definitely matter. They count. You know what I mean? Or when you're playing the Spurs or the Clippers, those top teams that are going to be there at the end. So
now, speaking of at the end, if at the end of the season the Warriors have the best record in the league, which one is the MVP candidate, do you think? Do you think Steph Curry will be an MVP candidate? Do you think Kevin Durant will be an MVP candidate?
It's rough.
Both maybe, but neither one win?
Yeah, I think they'll both be a candidate because the numbers are not too far off from what they – as a matter of fact, they're really close to what they were doing last season. So, you know, I think it'll be Durant and Steph, but neither one of them will get it. I think right now, first half of the season is – probably you're looking at Russell Westbrook or James Harden. I think those two guys have probably played the best. I would even throw LeBron in there as well, but I'll get to LeBron later. But I think with Westbrook, I mean, the triple-doubles that he's putting up is amazing, and then James Harden. But I think that where Russell Westbrook will miss out is the record of OKC, because they're not going to finish in the top four. They maybe steal the fourth spot, but I think they might be around five, in which case, if they are, then they're not going to give Westbrook the MVP. I think that Harden has a better chance, but I think that also leaves the door open for LeBron to actually get the MVP this season as well, because we know the Cavs are going to finish in first place, and especially when you get these kind of statement wins, like these games count to the voters as well. Those Christmas Day wins, you know, things like that. These big games. So
now, I mean, I said as soon as Kevin Durant left, it's in writing that, you know, Russell Westbrook, I felt, was the better of the two. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a close, obviously. It's not, you know, hands down. But I said that I felt that he would be able to pull off a big O with him leading the team without Durant there. And it looks like he's, you know, possible on doing it. But you're saying if they if they're not a top four team, you don't think that they'll...
I think that, and it's not me personally, you know what I mean? I may still give it to them depending on what everybody else does, but I feel like the way the voters have been voting, I feel like they're going to take that and put a lot more on them finishing fifth place. Even though it's in the West and it's just some, you know, that's just how they are when they're giving out those MVP awards. So I think that's going to actually hurt them. If they can't get into fourth place, especially when you're looking at Houston right now is in third place in the Western Conference. You know what I mean? And if Houston makes a move, you know, brings in somebody, I know they were talking about, actually both teams were talking about something for Rudy Gay, some kind of a deal for Rudy Gay. So if one of those guys can add a piece in, then I think, you know, the Rockets and James Harden can stay in that third place spot. Because James Harden, who would have thought as a point guard he was going to be doing what he's doing and the team not having Dwight Howard anymore and they're actually better than they were the last couple of years?
Yeah, I mean, James Harden, he obviously felt a little disappointed a couple of years ago when they gave it to Steph Curry instead of him. You know, the same three guys were in contention, Westbrook because Durant was injured. Harden because he was putting up ridiculous numbers, and of course Steph Curry got it. Mm-hmm. Last year it was unanimous. I mean, you can't really just doubt, nobody could really argue that Steph Curry deserved it last year. But this year, you know, moving to the point guard position, I mean, he was known for a shot creator, you know, putting threes over people's faces, and you have him doing Magic Johnson behind the back passes and
Where did that come from?
Cross court assists, like, you know, the passing precision on Harden is really unbelievable. I mean, he just continues to impress. He went from a sixth man to going to Houston and becoming a dominant scorer on a level that I never thought we would have seen. And then he takes it to another level, moving to the point guard position. So
you got to respect it. He's not the best defender by far.
Yeah, that's an understatement.
But on the offensive end, you know, and just the fact that he has stepped up into that point guard role and is facilitating the offense, the way that he is, like, you really have to tip your hat to James Harden, because that was an aspect of his game that we did not see before. And for him to just come in and, like, it's like, yo, he was playing point his whole career, you know what I mean? So you definitely got to respect what James Harden is doing. But those are my two top candidates right now, Harden, Westbrook. You know, like I said, though, I feel like the record is going to stop Westbrook from getting the team record, I should say, is going to stop them from, you know, him getting the MVP.
Now, let's say, you know, right now Harden's in and the Rockets are in third, Westbrook's in fifth. And the Thunder, if it stays that way with the standings, does the edge go to Harden because of the record?
Yeah, I think it goes to Harden because, I mean, if you look at the Golden State Warriors and the Spurs in comparison to OKC and to the Rockets, nobody expects for either one of those teams to be in first second because, you know, I mean, you got four superstars on Golden State, really. And then you got the Spurs who have, you know, a couple of superstars on their roster as well. You got the best defensive player in the league the past 2 years. Plus, you got, you know, one of the greatest coaches of all time, you know, leading the way with Greg Popovich. So, I don't think anybody is expecting either, you know, anybody else to be in that one seed or that two seed in the Western Conference. So, if you got the third seed in the West, that's pretty big, you know. And I think that is what would boost James Harden as far as MVP votes go. Because he really, I mean, who else is on James Harden's team? You know what I mean? Like, you took away, you know, an all-star center in Dwight Howard, and they're in third place in the West, which is the toughest conference to play in. And that's, you know, with the Spurs, with the Clippers, who, you know, might have a more complete, definitely have a more complete team. Got a couple more superstars. But here you have the Rockets in third place, and that's largely attributed to James Harden and what he's done at that point guard position.
Yeah, the Thunder, I mean, if anything, Westbrook has a better supporting cast. No other all-stars, but he's definitely
in a better position. You know, so, I mean, definitely these teams are not comparable to the top two teams. So, for him to finish third, I mean, you know, the Grizzlies are a really good, complete team in the Western Conference. Like I said, then you got the Clippers. So, to finish third, it's no slouch. So,
now, to the local team, my New York Knicks, losing in overtime to the Hawks, who are in the sixth seed. Knicks are in the fifth. I mean, I know in the beginning of the season, you kind of predicted that they'd be somewhere in the middle, somewhere between the four and the sixth seed. Now, they started off slow, and they seem like they had it more together. Hawks, obviously, tough competitor. Overtime could have went either way. Do you still have them there in the middle of the pack, or do you think they could move up to a second or third seed now that they seem to have a little bit more going for them?
They're getting better. I don't think they're going to move up until after the All-Star break. I did like that I actually finally saw a good game out of Joakim Noah. I think he 16 points, 13 rebounds, or 13, 16, one of those two. But we actually saw Joakim Noah playing like the Joakim Noah that they thought they were going to get. If that continues, they will start to climb the ladder faster. But we have to see that consistency out of Joakim Noah. What I will say, though, is that I like the chemistry right now amongst the Knicks is very strong and is getting stronger. Like, these guys really enjoy playing together. They're starting to, you know, to really gel. And there's a fire in the Knicks, and I'm getting that 1990s New York Knicks feel again. I know, you know, Melo got kicked out of the game, you know, the other day. You had the Kristaps Porzingis, you know, a couple of weeks ago. Hornacek, like, they are getting that fiery, and that's New York basketball, you know, right there. Like, we're not going to take nothing from nobody, you know, so I'm glad that they're starting to build. Like I said, I think after, you know, the All-Star break, that's when we're really going to see, little by little, the Knicks climbing up into that you know, the top three, top seed.
The Hornacek tee last night, it was Porzingis got called with an offensive foul for an elbow, and then back the other way, the Hawks should have gotten called for the exact same thing, and it wasn't. And obviously, Hornacek let the refs know, but definitely a lot more fire in the New York Knicks. I'm liking what I see. I think they could move up. I think they, you know, somewhere between the two and the four seed, I think, when it's all said and done at the end of the season. So,
yeah, well, I mean,
not just the New York's bias. I mean, we saw when we had Cortez here with his son, they were 9-9, finally at 500 after starting out, you know, under 500. And Now they're over, and, you know, they're
definitely, like I said, they're improving. The chemistry is getting better. I mean, Brandon Jennings is playing great this season, coming off the bench. Like, that was a great pickup.
The bench is a whole Kyle O'Quinn. He comes out there, you know.
And they were talking about trading him earlier this season, you know, and he's actually, when he's on the floor, he's giving the Knicks those valuable minutes. He's getting blocks. He's getting a couple of rebounds. So, you know, he's definitely doing his thing. The bench has definitely, you know, overperformed, you know, from what people thought of the Knicks bench, you know, what it was going to be. But Brandon Jennings is playing very well right now. Couple of double digit assist games, and he really has a good chemistry with the guys on the floor, you know. And then Derrick Rose, I mean, there's nights where he just looks really amazing. You might want to see him throw it down occasionally, but you'll take the reverse under the, you know, layup, spin move, and all that. You'll take those, even though you want a nice dunk every now and again, but you'll take the layups as long as he's going to be healthy and stay on the court. So,
don't want to risk those knees. So.
Exactly. So, like I said, if they can get Joakim Noah to be more consistent, that's when you'll see the Knicks climbing that ladder. As soon as Noah, you know, just starts playing. I don't want to say he's playing like he's afraid to get hurt again, but he just has to.
He led in minutes yesterday. And yeah. He's been talking about how conditioning is very important because they want to play up-tempo, not slowly bringing the ball up the court and everything, and you need to have the stamina for that. So, He's working on the conditioning, and he put in the minutes yesterday in the overtime game, led the Knicks in minutes, so they're not restricting anything. He's definitely 100%.
Which is good. Which is a good sign, you know, because that's the thing that the Knicks have been missing most, and that's the presence of Joakim Noah this season. Because I think everyone has exceeded, you know, expectations of what they're supposed to do. I mean, Melo, you know, he's going to be Melo every night. You know, he's going to be one of the toughest scorers in the league to guard. Porzingis has improved on his game from last year, which we all knew he was going to continue, you know, to improve. But he, you know, he has a swag, a confidence about him right now as a second year player that you really gotta love. And then you got Derrick Rose, who's playing. He's not MVP Derrick Rose, but he's approaching All Star Derrick Rose with the way that he's been playing. And Courtney Lee has been well, and Brandon Jennings and the rest of these guys off the bench, you know, so. Just give him a little bit more time, You know, and then, you know, like I said, after the All-Star break, they'll start to get hot. They'll get up there, and then they can prepare for the beatdown of their lives in the playoffs at the hands of the Cleveland Cavaliers.
I mean, before we jump ahead of ourselves now, I mean, you know, the fact that Kylo Quinn and others are playing well, I think that might have lit a spark under Noah, you know, so he doesn't get Tony Romo'd for that starting spot because Hornacek has been rotating it, so, you know, playing time and everything in the center position, so... And I think that the Knicks have one of the best starting fives in the league.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, you have the Warriors with four superstars, but, you know, you got four potential all-stars with the Knicks there. And then you got, you know, one of, if not the best benches in the league, I think. Yeah. So I think their bench is better than the Golden State bench. I'll put it to you that way.
Well, Golden State doesn't really have a bench. I mean, they got Livingston, who's... kind of declined. He started to decline really like late last season. You got Iguodala, who is on a decline as well. And then, you know, those little ticky-tack injuries at his age, they start to add up. He hasn't been playing the way he was playing before, you know. So, and outside of that, they might be getting their best bench production out of David West. He is not even really doing much of anything either, you know. So, but that's the, you know, you give up certain things in order to bring over Kevin Durant. That's one of the sacrifices that Golden State had to make. You know, they gave up a bench. They gave up some really good defensive players, a lot of energy to bring in. Yeah, it's great. You bring in, you know, second best player, arguably second, third best player in basketball. But, you know, you still got to consider the things that you're losing as well. And that's, you know, the bench is definitely one of the things that they missed out on by bringing Durant over. And it's okay versus, you know, the Hornets, the Kings, the Suns, you know, it's okay versus those teams, but it's not okay when you're playing the Spurs, who have a very deep team. You know, the Clippers have a deep team. The Cavs have some great players on the bench. So you need that bench, especially come playoff time. Guys get tired, get winded. And I'm starting to look at Kevin Durant, you know, in that last couple of minutes now, and, you know, he has not been playing well, you know, playoffs, and then a couple of big games in the last couple of minutes. I'm noticing that about Kevin Durant. So he's going to have to step that up because, I mean, we saw in the playoffs last year, being up 3-1, he could not come through, you know, them last three games at all.
Starting to look like LeBron James of old.
Nah, he's not starting to look like LeBron James of old.
The fourth quarter, because he actually
had a superstar with him who might have even been better than him, and Russell Westbrook. LeBron never had nobody that good on his team during that time. That makes a huge difference.
Well, Dwayne Wade, and, you know, the first year with the Heat, he was fourth quarter collapsing.
Yeah, he in the finals. He had one series.
Not, so speaking of us conditioning and falling apart in the fourth quarter, one thing I forgot to mention with the New York Giants, a lot of people don't notice, they fired their strength and conditioning coach from last season before the season started. We noticed a huge difference because last year, the fourth quarter was a collapse for the Giants as well. So just switching back to the Giants for a second before we take a little bit of a break. We got a very special video for you guys. Trip Young, you want to go into the archives on...
Yeah, I went back. You know, I pulled out the Anthony Mason footage from the Rucker. And I noticed, you know, we didn't put that out, so we decided to put that out there. Anthony Mason Jr., Antoine Mason, and, of course, the Statman made an appearance in the video as well. But we were actually at the Rucker that weekend for Team Oue, which Anthony Mason Jr., he was playing for Team Oue during the EBC Classic. So they were out there. They were champions. So, you know, we were out there watching the game. And we got the chance to chop it up with Oom P after the game. Oom P is he's the owner or manager, GM, whatever you want to call it, of Team Oue. But you probably know him, you know, as a rapper as well. He was a battle rapper. Got a couple of joints on the radio with Jadakiss. Got a couple of mixtapes out right now, the whole Facts series. So we got the chance to talk to him about the team and, you know, about what he was working on. So we're going to jump into to that video. But before we do that, Make sure you guys are following us on social media, realfansrealtalk.com, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk, Twitter and Instagram at realfantalk, and then subscribe to that channel on YouTube, youtube.com/forthefansproductions. It's a whole lot of stuff on that YouTube channel, a whole lot of interviews that y'all might want to get to if you haven't already. See what's going on with your favorite athletes, your favorite entertainers, your favorite musicians, your favorite authors, actors, all that. We got everything on that YouTube channel, so subscribe to that channel. And with that being said, I guess we could jump into that OMP video.
Hey, it's your girl Bianca Bonnie from Love & Hip Hop New York. You already know I'm rocking with Real Fans.
RealFansRealTalk.com. With Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and Intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if
we just coming in with the same intensity, you know, start out aggressive from the tip off and just try to run off with the lead and take it from there, you know what I mean? From this year and last year, I know you remember when the Heat beat the Spurs 2 years ago, and the way the Spurs came back this year, that's Uwe. We're coming back to take everything. Basically, that's what we try to do. We try to not keep it close because we don't want the refs feeling nervous about no calls, making a funny call at the end. So we try to just come out aggressive from the start and just take that lead so the refs can have an easy job at the end. We like to make the game boring, basically. Yeah. To turn up the players, because the players see the coach going off and it make them want to turn up in the game, you know what I'm saying, at the same time. So, you know, coach just got to get his point across. He wants his team to win, and so he's going to do whatever it takes to get his team to win. So if he got to go crazy on the sideline, that's what he's going to do, you know what I mean? Shouts to Coach Hove, too. Salute. We've been around for a minute. This is like probably our fifth year in street ball. We started out in Tri-State on 145th and Lenox Avenue. Then we did 2 years in Dykeman, and now this is our second year in EBC. And all we're looking for is a chip. We need our chip. So when we come back, we want to hear that. Defending champions, we need to hear that. And, you know, to put on, my team is from the Bronx. We come from the Projects, more senior air rights. So, you know, we just want to make that statement for the Bronx. And shout out to my OTS family, my Harlem, my Broadway. You know, we all come together and try to make this thing work, man. And we just want to bring that chip back. Got that New York single on the radio, Crazy, featuring the bro Jadakiss. You know, we got the remix coming soon. Y'all stay tuned to that. And, you know, it's just taking over. We just repping where we from, you know. Shout out to Stupid on the Beach. You know, video coming soon. We shot it right here in Rucker Park. You know, we had to keep it hood and bring it out here, man, for the people. All the young kids get to see what's going on, what we doing. So, you know, look out for that New York single. Y'all could go get the Facts 2 mixtape on datpiff.com right now for free. Go get that. Shout out to my bro, Ty. Come here, Ty the Owl, man.
It's all crazy,
yeah, it's my bro, Jacquay, right here.
Yeah.
Stupid singles out, that big. Booty Judy's, yeah, on iTunes. Make sure I go get that right now. That's hard. It's coming out. Let them know what that's hard stand for.
How you apply yourself reflects your role, meaning whatever you do in life always represent that shit, huh?
That's hard. Go to iTunes, go get that. Jacquay, that's hard. H-A-R.
And he on a remix too. What up?
Snapple Facts.
RealTalk.com. With Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and Intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stat. All right,
we are back live. Real Fans, Real Talk. Mark the Stat Man, Skevich. Alongside Trip Young, another interview in the books. A little bit of a throwback there.
Shout out to Jacquay too, because that was actually dope. Because this was before we actually had met Jacquay and actually had him on the show a couple of times at the Ballin' for Peace events. This is before he had those two hit singles. He's been on the radio all over the place, about every dollar, and before his pieces was hitting. And OMP just brought him over. We were shooting the interview. So shout out to Jacquay, who's also been on the show a couple of times. All right, but and shout out to OMP as well. He got the new video out with Dave East right now. That's kicking. So definitely wanna check that out. And With that being said, though, there is an actual fight going down this week in a little MMA action. Ladybug's bestie, Ronda Rousey, is fighting. She's stepping back in the ring for the first time since Holly's home knocked the stew beef out of her, as my grandmother would say, in her last fight with a kick to the noggin. But she is stepping back in the ring. Are you extremely confident in Ronda Rousey in this one?
I can't really be extremely confident in her. I don't even think she's extremely confident in her. She went and was a little too confident in herself before the kick to the mm-hmm. head. And I think that, you know, the kick to the head kind of humbled her in a sense.
It definitely humbled her.
To not go out there talking trash and everything as much as Conor McGregor.
Yeah. It didn't affect him. Him getting choked out didn't really affect him.
Just,
he came back talking more than ever.
No matter what.
Yeah.
But don't see too much of that with her. I think she will bounce back. If I had to pick a winner on that one, I would go with Ronda Rousey. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't bet the farm on it, though. But not like I have a farm, but you know what
I
mean.
Yeah, I got you. I got you. I agree, man. I'm not confident. Like, when you get knocked out like that, you know, and then to get back in the ring, I have to actually see it first, because it was bad. It was like, it was a really bad knockout. And, I mean, it took a long time to even come back to the ring. So I think that there's going to be a little bit of nerves. I think if she starts off the fight well, I think the nervousness will go away. But if she doesn't, if it's like, you know, kind of back and forth, I don't know, I can't call it, but I definitely would not put my money on Ronda Rousey in this one. This is something I'd have to just wait, watch, and see how she does. And if she dominates and is just right back to the same Ronda Rousey, then maybe on the next fight. But on this fight right now, I just think it's a toss-up. Like, I really just can't just say Ronda Rousey's going to win.
Yeah, I mean, a toss-up, not even the favorite?
I'm not. I mean, I guess she's the favorite because she's Ronda Rousey, but honestly, I got it 50-50, man. She got beat bad. Like, that was a bad knockout. Like, that does a lot to, I mean, look, that it did a lot to her psyche.
I think it's more the mental, you know, is she mentally ready for the fight more so than
physical
skills? But I think,
I don't know.
I mean, fighters bounce back after tough losses all the time. I mean, her, she took it to another level, the way it affected her.
That's
but
what
I guess
I mean,
was just, she, a lot of people felt she was invincible, but nobody felt she was more invincible than her. She thought there was no way she's losing ever, and she got some sense knocked into her. And
that's
that
the thing. That's a lot. I mean, we were talking about, you know, her being talking about, you know, suicidal after the loss. Like, that's a lot psychologically that you're dealing with. So that does not give me confidence going to just pick her and say, yeah, she's hands down, she's gonna win this thing. I don't know.
I mean, it's embarrassing to her too, and plus she was at the top of the world. You told talk about the movies and everything. She was
video game cover.
Biggest name in UFC, more so than anybody else. I mean, Conor McGregor was on the come up, but when you think UFC, you don't even think of any of the male fighters.
Exactly.
She was the biggest name. She was making the money with the movies, and, you know, she talked all the trash, and she backed it up, and then, you know, the backing
up. Then she got backed up.
She got backed up, yeah.
The ring. Shout out to Holly Holm, man. That was the kick felt around the world, man. When that kick went upside Ronda Rousey's head, man, it was, you know, the whole world just jaws dropped. It was like, yo, is this really happening
Ronda's
right now?
Ronda's jaw got broken.
Exactly. Is this really going on? And yes, it is. And she was laid out, and that was it, man. Holly Holm got that. So, I mean, I'm definitely going
to
watch, though.
It could make Ronda Rousey better for the long term to not let, you know, because she doesn't have the ego so much anymore. So maybe the humbling did good for her in the long term, because it's bound to happen that you're going to lose at some point or another. So I think I'm taking her to win. Like I said, I'm not 100% confident as I would be in the old Ronda Rousey days. But it should be interesting to see her get back in the ring. I'm sure a lot of people looking forward to that, including myself.
Nah.
But we were talking about the Rucker event, and obviously Anthony Mason Jr., part of Team Oue, and he was there with the family on three kids at the St. John's game recently. Could you tell us about that?
Oh yeah, we went out 2 weeks ago. Myself, Anthony Mason Jr., family on three. So I was out there filming for them, and he took the kids from the shelter not too far from Madison Square Garden. I think it was about 12 kids. You know, he took out him, and shout out to Vance and Chrissy as well, because they also came out, but brought the kids out, took them to the St. John's game. St. John's got beat down by Penn State, so, you know, that wasn't a good look, but, you know, it was I felt bad seeing Coach Mullen on the side, man, just bugging out, because it got real ugly real fast, but, you know, the kids had a good time. Took it back to the shelter. We hung out with the kids for a little while. You know, Mace and the whole family on three bought pizzas, snacks, and stuff for the kids. Played a little basketball. And then, you know, got to sit with the kids and really, you know, have a nice heart-to-heart talk. And I think that, the kids definitely appreciated that. They were all, you know, really involved in the conversation, what was going on. Like, they all were paying attention. So it was definitely another great experience. Good way to end off the year with that. And then, you know, last week we had the Christmas special, giving away the boots to all of the youth activists from the Yaya Network. So that, you know, that was a great, great, show. So I think we definitely ended off the year, you know, good, doing our part. If you guys aren't out there doing your part in your community, man, y'all need to step your games up. You know, it's a lot going on. I definitely want to shout out Anthony Mason Jr. and Haron H2O Hargrave, because those two gentlemen are putting a lot of work in for the community and working with our youth. Like, they did a whole lot in 2016, so I definitely want to shout those two guys out, you know. And the next Ballin' for Peace game is actually going down at St. John's in March. So you guys definitely, you know, should be looking into getting your tickets for that. If you want to get a little discount, y'all could use the Rfrt promo code on that one. Just holla at myself for the stat. But you can hit us up on the Instagram, the Twitter, at Real Fan Talk, if you need more information about Ballin' for Peace. Or you can go on the website as well, realfansrealtalk.com, for that. It's going to be another crazy game. Shout out to my boo thing, Bianca Bonnie, too, for shouting us out on the beginning of that that video right there. She's doing her thing on Love and Hip Hop right now, you know, so playing the home record role. But it's all good. That's how it goes down sometimes, man.
Pretty much.
You know?
But, of course, we had the NBA 2K tournament for the family on three kids, too, and we had a great turnout. We might have another one come playoff times in the NBA. Might have a Madden tournament that might be in the works, but make sure you follow us on social media to stay tuned with that. And, of course, it'll benefit charity as always. Make sure you're following us on Twitter and Instagram at Real Fan Talk, at facebook.com/RealFansRealTalk. Hit that like button. Get involved with any of the future events that we have coming up. Of course, go to the RealFansRealTalk.com website and see future charity events. Shout out to Petro Home Services for sponsoring both the boot drive and the 2K tournament. So definitely appreciate the generosity of Petro Home Services.
And they brought some hats too, you know, for the kids. So you can't knock
them. And myself too.
Exactly. You know, so it was definitely a dope way for us to end off the year. And we got a couple of surprises coming up in 2017. So you guys definitely make sure you guys are in the loop on all our social media, because that's who's gonna know first, the guys that are on Instagram. Or you could just hit us up in the group page too. We're gonna be doing a lot of smack talk in the next coming weeks in the group page as the NFL playoffs start. So it's gonna be going down. Oh, I gotta say this stat, man. I feel bad on a sad note, man. I didn't want to bring this up, but I had to, I figured we would have Ladybug say she probably was gonna talk about this, so I didn't want to bring it up. But I said, you know what, I gotta say, there's been a breakup, you know, with my main man, the Zen Master Phil Jackson and Jeannie Buss.
Yep.
I didn't want to talk about it, but I just want to tell.
Probably a good thing.
Tell the Zen Master, just keep hope alive, man. You know, it was not because it was crazy, because I had just just going through all the footage.
He might have went to the Lakers, next
I think
year,
it
you
know,
yeah,
but
the future. But
I
now
know
that's
it's a split, man.
Crazy,
it was the East Coast West Coast thing again, man. Like, they finally had that breakup, and I was watching the Rfrt Gina tribute, so I just seen the picture with him with the Knicks hat on and Jeannie Buss with the Lakers hat on in the back of the limo doing the nod to Derek Jeter. And then right after that, I just looked and I'm like, oh man, the Zen Master broke up. What happened, man? That's crazy, man. But shout out to the Zen Master, man. Everything's been, ever since he said that about LeBron's posse.
Yeah, she's not part of his posse anymore.
She's not part of his posse anymore, man. I don't know what's going on, man. They got to get together. They got to at least, you know, finish the season strong for Phil, man. Because he going to need the boost of his spirits. He lost his bae. As they say in
that. I don't think he called her his bae. It's a little bit old.
Wouldn't that be funny, though, if Phil called her his
bae? I would like to hear that recording.
Exactly. And, hey, you know, hey, bae, what's up? Take that Lakers jersey off. I'm with the Knicks now. Nah, well, it's going to be some things going on next year. So I definitely want you guys to stay tuned in. We had a great year. Thank you to everyone at home that supported us this year, that came out to one of the charity events that we had, all of the guests that either came on to the show or who we went to see this year. We got a lot more in store for you guys in 2017. And definitely got to give a huge, huge thank you to the crew because they had an amazing year as well. Winning that Beta Award, you know, that's all attributed to the crew and the work that they put in for Real Fans, Real Talk. So shout out to all of you guys as well. We got a lot more coming.
Cliff got his MVP award here at Brick.
He definitely did. The Eagles didn't get to the Super Bowl this year.
I mean, yeah, they're 6-9 right now, and they're probably going to be 6-10. But exactly. You know, that's besides the point.
You're right. I'm sorry, Stan. I don't even know why I brought that up.
Now, 2016 is in the books. Another year for Real Fans, Real Talk. Another award and everything. But what was your favorite part of Real Fans, Real Talk? Favorite interview, favorite whatever of 2016?
What was my favorite of 2016? It would have to be. This is rough. I'm gonna have to say it's a toss up, man. I'm gonna have to name my top five. I'm not gonna put this in any specific order.
Well, you got about 2 minutes to.
All right. Well, I'm gonna go with February when we had the kids on, the Cardinals on after they coming off their Super Bowl win, the Glencoe Cardinals. So that's in my top five. I'm gonna go with the Bino interview because that was just you know being a fan of the Riot Squad. Then I'm gonna go the Brooklyn Way interview. I'm gonna go with the Respect Life interview. That was a fun one. And then I think the last one is gonna be the Math interview. Just the way he just came up in here, busting on us on the set, walked in, then put his feet up on Big Mama's table, lay on the place.
I mean, that part's a little disrespectful.
You know,
but that was
probably in my top five. Shout out to Math and the cast from Respect Life, the Brooklyn Way, Bino, and the Glen Cove Cardinals. They're gonna be joining us coming up next year as well. They did not win the Super Bowl this year. They didn't repeat, but you know they did make it back to the playoffs and they did well. So we're gonna have them come back as well, probably in February again, maybe around the Super Bowl.
Mine was John Starks, by the way. since you know he took up the majority of the time, but I technically interviewed him, so I guess that's probably why. But definitely great to reminisce on the good old Knicks in the 90s. So with John Starks, for which was supposed to be a quick conversation, but he was there for the whole 30 to 40 minutes chopping it up with me, didn't speed things up for me or whatnot. So definitely great, always a pleasure to interview former Nick. So that was definitely my favorite to top 2016. A lot more coming on in 2017, as Tripp Young mentioned. So for our last 2016 episode, we just want to wish you all a happy and safe new year. Hopefully 2017 is better than your 2016. And thank you for joining us on Real Fans, Real Talk. For Tripp Young, I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. Happy New Year again. Have a good night, everyone.
No bye to Ladybug.
Later, Ladybug.
Real Fans, Real Talk.com. Where Arthur Dom is Tripp Young and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real Fans, Real Talk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
Well, log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda.